Clay is nothing but potential. It's really exciting to see somebody just get it and like to touch it for the first time, like, wow, this is mesmerizing. I like the idea of bringing people together until it becomes something on its own. You light that curiosity and they're gonna keep that fire burning. The spark is just starting. It's always a striving. It's always like, this is really great in this piece and this is really great in this piece, but how can I bring those together into one piece? And it's always like finding things that you can do better and finding things that you enjoy, but then how you make it into something more. So it's a constant improving. My name is Monica Leap, and I'm the founder and programs manager of Studio 550 Art Center in Manchester, New Hampshire. We are a community art center that brings people together with the arts. And so whether that is somebody that's never done it before or somebody that is already experienced with it, we provide a space for people to be creative. I'm very much a potter, so you could work with clay and be a sculptor as well. That's not really how I do it, but there's beautiful things that happen with that. This is a metal rib. I'm just pressing it along the outside and it will help smooth off all those flat clay particles so you get a nice even sheen. And it also helps to compress the clay and then remove the extra moisture. I love clay because it becomes art that you can use in your daily life. Something that, you know, you pick it up, it's not just something you put on the wall, you use it for your coffee, you're holding it, just you're very much like, you're interacting with it. You're reminded of either the person that gave you that thing, or when you were making it, or who you were thinking of when you're making it, or the person that gave it to you. It's a wonderful memento and reminder of just, like, the people that are part of your life. I just think it's beautiful. New Hampshire is my home. I grew up a half hour south of here in Nashua. My parents came from Cambodia. They moved here in 1981. They were refugees of the Khmer Rouge auto genocide. They came here with my brother. My mom was pregnant. And so we didn't start with much. Everything that we have is because of their practicality and their frugality and their just very, very mindful way of being in life. Be efficient, be resourceful, be practical. I think just by living, they've instilled those lessons. The reason why we ended up here in Manchester is because my parents had an Asian market here, an international food store, and they were in this building. When they stopped the store here, they were moving to another location. My parents knew the owner, and I was graduating from school at the same time. We just kind of worked together. They think, oh, I know my daughter really wants to build this community arts center. Kind of happened at the right time. So they were really excited to have my dream come true, as every parent's dream, to have their kid be able to do what they wanted to do. And so they were excited. This is the handmade gift shop. We have work from artists from around the state and also from around the country. There's pottery, there's stained glass, and we also have a paint-your-own pottery station as well. It's all handmade pieces from staff here at our space, so you're supporting a local artist as well as a small business. If it's your first time in, this is probably the space that you're going to be in. This is our primary clay classroom. We have the wheel set up in the middle so people can talk to each other, and so this will be a little bit more set up for community building and sharing of ideas and seeing what other people are working on. So I've been fortunate enough to have mentors in my life who've really told me the value of community. And so when I was going to school for clay, having really practical Asian parents, it never really came up that, you know, you should be an artist. You should be something really practical. It was an evolution over years of going through school. An art teacher in high school, her name was Robin Parent, just a fantastic woman. She sat down and asked, have you ever considered a career in the arts? And at that point, I hadn't.
When I was first really introduced to Monica, it ended up being two other art teachers that had already had her in an earlier class that wanted us to all have a meeting. So the three of us sat down with Monica and everyone was saying, Monica, you need to be an artist. You know, if no one has told you this, we're telling you this now. She took ceramics just to also take another class and she loved it. If I needed glazes mixed or clay made or kilns loaded, she was right there. Like, she wanted to do all that kind of work.
And so I started thinking, like, oh, maybe I'll be an art teacher because I love what she's doing. And if I could do something that she's doing, like, my life would be fulfilled. I proposed that to my parents, and they were talking, but how are you going to make a living? I could teach, but maybe there's more I could do with this. So I went to school for art ed, and then I decided, you know, I'm going to become a jack of all trades in that field. So I think instead I'm going to focus on ceramics because I love it. There's so much potential with working with clay. You all start with the same stuff, but you put your own thoughts into it, your own experiences into it, and then it becomes something totally different. In high school, I would, luckily the teachers would just like let me stay there after school, and I would stay there until the lights turned off on me, and I'm like, oh, I guess I should go home. And so I would just be like messing around, making my mistakes, getting bad habits, but thoroughly enjoying the process until I got kicked out. And so so when I went to college, was the time to like to refine all those skills, to figure out these different ideas. Clay is nothing but potential, and I really love that about it.
I'm still mesmerized by watching someone throw on the potter's wheel. It's just a process that is seemingly miraculous to take this lump and then it just kind of grows.
David McDonald was my teacher in undergrad at Syracuse, and being the functional potter, I gravitated towards David McDonald.
I saw something in her enthusiasm, dedication, and discipline, which was kind of more than what the average introductory level student would display. After one or two semesters of working with her, I realized that she demonstrated that whatever she decided to lend her considerable talents and energies to, she was going to be successful at.
I found that like every semester I would focus on something. So one semester was just porcelain. I made porcelain lanterns. Next session, I might have been making sculpture. Next session, I might have been making pumpkin casserole dishes. And so I made a bunch of pumpkins. And so every session was a little bit different. So I was like trying to find what I enjoyed the most, but also wanted to try all these different things while I had the resources for it.
I realized that she had a very keenly developed social consciousness. One of the experiences that I had with her that really demonstrated how committed she was the Empty Bowls project.
So the Empty Bowls movement, community comes together and they're raising funds for a local soup kitchen. Everybody will craft ceramic bowls and we'll fire them. And then at this event, local restaurants will donate soups. And so you have a simple meal of soup and bread in this handmade ceramic bowl that you get to pick. There's this whole line of tables with just hundreds of bowls. And you get to pick the bowl that, you know, that speaks to you. You have your simple meal of soup and bread in there, and then you take it home as a reminder of those who truly do have empty bowls.
Monica's social consciousness is just not about rhetoric. It's about the act of doing.
A craftsperson is not powerless to make a difference in the community. They can really do something. And this is just one event that brings a lot of people together to make something happen. We're primarily a clay studio, but we also have stained glass, drawing, painting, and other art. We offer workshops and classes for the complete beginner, for people to really get immersed in the arts. The subject that we proposed was throwing bigger by combining two elements, and then also talking about making surprises on the bottom. The spark for me is lighting the spark in other people. The goal is to bake a bigger pie. You're not trying to take a slice of the pie, you're trying to make a bigger pie. So I'm trying to make more potters so like all the art studios can have potters. I'm going to give you guys a ball of clay, about a pound and a half of clay, and then some calipers. And we're going to try to make either the top dimension or the bottom dimension of those pieces that dimension. And we're going to stack them together. It's not necessarily about making big, it's about making something a little bit different, making something that you didn't think was possible before, and you can do what you want with it. You already have the skills to do this. This one right here, 3-ish pounds or so. This one maybe only a pound and a half. But when you put them together, it becomes bigger, a larger piece. Throw whatever you're comfortable with. You don't need to stress out your body by trying to muscle in 5 to 10 pounds of clay. Just do a little bit at a time.
Monica is a very, very considerate and deliberate person. Everything that she does, there is a reason to the order that she does it, and she gets joy in going through the steps of getting something done.
Your bowl, You can do whatever kind of imagery you want in the middle. This is where people are going to be interacting with your piece. You're going to see the inside. It's really often where you pick up a pot, you flip it over, you want to see the bottom. You want to see who made this, what did they do there, what kind of decision making happened with this piece, and it's an opportunity to put something on the bottom.
She enjoys all of the aspects of working with clay, even the things that are kind of messy. Having that dedication to a business and to the process and the art form that you're working through really makes you appreciate that end product all the more so.
And so when I was making that bowl, I was rushing it, which you should never do. Never ever do that. I was rushing it and I totally messed up the foot and I had to carve the whole thing off. So that's actually a thrown foot ring. Everything we do is just iterative, right? So you do it, you like a certain part of it, and you don't like another part of it, and you bring those lessons on to the next piece. And so by cutting away above or below the cut portions, you can start to frame it, which makes the hacking look a little bit more intentional and clean. I studied clay because I really wanted to get a deep understanding of this field, and in knowing that, then I'd be able to share that joy and that love for it better. I like the idea of bringing people together until it becomes something on its own. The people are the joy, and they're also like the learning element for me too, right? So right now we're in the members pottery studio. This is a space for people that just need time and access to equipment and space to work. So we have pottery wheels for people to work on, table space for people to do sculpting, storage for all their works in progress. People often start at our studio complete beginners, and they get to the point where they don't need the classes anymore and they're ready for membership. And that's when people kind of migrate into this room. We call them like kind of like they graduate into this space. Over here we have our glaze area. The two main kinds of clay that we work with, there's the warm white and then the speckled tan. And on each glaze tile we have a texture and then we have an underglaze line so you can start to understand the properties of the glaze. So when you're glazing, it's not just picking the favorite color, it's about picking the color and considering the quality of the glass. You can see some things are opaque, say this one you can't really see the underglaze line through, and some are translucent, like that, you can see it right through there. And then some of them will really fill in the texture rather. And then some will really highlight it. So like this one will really like fill in, the colors will kind of fill in the deeper spaces and really make them pop. So the actual imagery that goes onto my pieces, it's much more about peace. Thinking about how these handmade objects, when they're being used, they're supposed to like slow you down a little bit. They're supposed to make you a little bit more mindful and remind you of the people. And so the mark making that's going on the pieces now, it's not so much a story, it's more so of a feeling. It's a lot more of like, here's the feeling of like a peaceful, quiet, rainy day. Here's the feeling of being in the woods. And so the imagery comes a little bit more from nature. It's like that feeling of like waking up after camping in the night and you have this beautiful morning sunlight coming in. It's just really peaceful. That's what I'm shooting for. Experiment with it. You have to start to get to know your materials, get to know the different glazes, how they behave, how they layer onto each other. It's not just color mixing, it's chemistry. And so you have to think about what is going on first, how you're applying it, is it thick, is it thin? It's a lot about doing a thing, revisiting it, learning from mistakes, taking the notes that you enjoyed, and then repeating that in the next piece. Try to do these in process pieces. Each clipboard has a little get to know what's on here. So it says like one layer of blue jay here, two layers of seafoam on top. And so you can see like, you can compare notes and be like, okay, this is what's here, this is what's here. And then you can start to break down the process. And then it says, this is the name of the technique, this is what it is, this is why you would do it, and this is the steps. And so again, we're just trying to get people acquainted with the process of glazing because it is totally a skill and we'd like people to be happy with what they're taking home. Just because clay is a very energy intensive process. When I was in school, did a minor in entrepreneurship just to learn a little bit more of the business aspect of things because I started thinking like, oh, you know, maybe I'll own an art center because it's not just so like self-serving working in the studio because it's hard work being a solo entrepreneur, a solo artist working in the space. So I wanted to build something that was a little bit bigger, a little bit more sustainable, something that could grow bigger than myself. The small business community in Manchester, I've never done business anywhere else. But I feel like we're very fortunate where we are. We have a mayor that is very supportive of small business. We have a chamber of commerce that's very active. And then the small businesses themselves, like we work together. So we'll do like a downtown passport over the holidays. So we all kind of like share marketing and work together. So it's a very interactive community here. This is a space that is our multi-purpose space. Our multi-purpose room, and typically we rent it out for like yoga classes, dance group. We do our 2D drawing and painting classes in here as well. Right now it is set up as our handmade holiday market, and so these are all makers that are members at our studio. They all had the task of creating the work and then putting together a display so that they could mark their brand. I really am drawn to this piece right here. This is Steve Umstead. Look at how he treated the back. Look at that. So it ties in with the front. The colors are really stunning. And he's considered how he did his signature as well. It's not just like scrawled in there. It's centered and it's his initials, which is really, really thoughtful. We are trying to teach people how to sell and be a good vendor. So as part of it is like the coaching of the people that have, this is like their first selling experience. Gives them an opportunity to realize like, oh, okay, this is a hobby that is actually sustainable. And so I can actually pay for the clay and I can pay for the thing that brings me a lot of joy. But there's a lot of really great people doing great things. We're trying to figure out how to bring them together. Rich from Dance and Lion Chocolate. I have made serving ware for him for his actual cafe service, drinking chocolate bowls for his shops and pouring pitchers for his hot chocolate. Every time I speak with him, I learn something.
Monica! It's good to see you, and we need the bowls, thank you. Shall we go over and open these up?
Yeah, let's go take a seat.
Dancing Lion Chocolate, we work with very small cacao farms and artisan chocolate makers around the world. Our truffles and bonbons, we make a recipe one time. About 100 of a piece, when they are gone forever. We have never in 15 years repeated a recipe. I've known Monica for about 10 years. Monica makes all our serviceware, our bowls, when we need something new. She's always creative about it. We don't mind things looking different every time we get something, and I love that.
Ooh, that drip. The drip's great.
You want the foot to go like that, too? I can do that, too. Like the smooth versus the bump.
I like the smooth a little bit better.
Yeah, I can do that.
Again, more of that kind of calabash, less of a bowl, right? It's.
So if you feel the bottom, I started sanding the bottom so they feel a little bit more smooth. So each one goes through so many stages.
And every one of them is different.
Thank you. Dude.
Perfect. In the bowls. Well, I think we hit off so well because our businesses are actually almost identical. They're just different businesses.
That's a different kind of art. So I make art that you can use. You make art that you can eat.
But they're both art. I think the community starts that way though, because it's you can come in and just sort of be part of a community, but we
have similar ideas and want to do something really great for the city.
Yeah, we want to do art and such in the community.
So I feel like public art is really fantastic for a city because it changes the cityscape and gives people a sense of like wayfinding and pride and makes the city a little bit more beautiful. We're all doing interesting things and they're all really exciting. They're all really beautiful. And they all have a ton of energy behind it. As a whole, it makes Manchester really fantastic.
But I think that reflects Manchester. So Manchester's this old mill city. The push has been very steadily more and more interesting art stuff.
You can take just something that art exists and turn that into something beautiful. And so Manchester had all these utility boxes downtown. So it was a partnership of the city and artists and sponsors to like make this whole thing happen. It changes the way it looks, but on another level, it changes the way you feel about a space. When you change something, how something looks, you change your feeling of pride towards it and how you associate with the space. It's not just a drab gray cityscape, it's got vibrancy, it has colors. The Manchester art scene is evolving. There are all the different artists and the small businesses that do their arts and sell downtown that work together.
One of the things that's important to keep in mind is that whatever you choose, you should choose because you enjoy the lifestyle that's associated with it. If it's a job, it's a way of earning money, then you'll quickly become disenchanted with it.
But what I find is why I do this is because when you get all those people together, something else happens and they make their own spark. You light that curiosity and they're gonna keep that fire burning. And it's just so exciting.
It's so nice when people as adults have that realization, like, I want to express myself. I want to be creative. When, you know, a 50-year-old person goes to her and says, I've always wanted to throw in the wheel, you know, can you teach me? And that's just, you know, she lives for that.
She got in contact with me a number of years ago to come and do a weekend workshop.
His wife was like, you need to eat. You need to stop, we're gonna go. And he's like, no, I'm going to stay here and I'm gonna leave Monica with some bisque-fired pieces. He really wanted to finish things so he could leave them here for our students to learn from and to see. So I'm really glad. That's why they're up there on the wall.
A lot of our programs, especially ceramic programs around the state, have been closing. And there are not many places you can go and still work in clay. And she's just that gem.
I always had people that I respected that believed in me. I had that with my parents first, and then with my teachers, and then with my mentors, and then now with Rich, with the business aspect of things. I think it's an African proverb, but if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. And that's kind of what I've learned with this space. Like it comes alive when there's other people that are helping to make it a space instead of just a place.